Okay, let me then introduce. I don't think that Valery Frolov is worth introduction. So he will talk about black holes in the limiting curvature theory of gravity.
Okay, thank Andrei for your not introducing me. we started 5 minutes later, so I will keep looking at time. First of all, thanks organizers for the opportunity to speak at this interesting workshop. So this talk is based on the recent work done in collaboration with Andrei Zelnikov, and we submitted this preprint to archive on May 26. Famous Penrose and Hawking theorems on singularities inside black holes imply that the general relativity does not give consistent description of the space-time in the black hole interior. We know example of exact stationary black hole solution in the Einstein gravity, and all of them have curvature singularity in the interior. For example, for Hirsch-Schwarzschild black hole, Kretschmann invariant square of the curvature is inverse proportional to the 6th power of radius. Physically, it means that in the vicinity of singularity, tidal forces infinitely grows. It means that it's impossible to have objects which are extended. They will be disrupted by tidal forces. So for this reason, standard assumption of general relativity that there exist clocks and rulers becomes wrong, and we cannot anymore use standard description of space-time in the vicinity of singularity. So in order to escape this unpleasant situation, Markov in 82 proposed that a consistent theory of gravity must satisfy what is called limiting curvature principle. So following his arguments, we can propose the following limiting curvature condition. Theory must require the following property. There should exist a fundamental length L so that curvature or space-time never exceed some constant divided by L square. R is a scalar invariant which can be constructed from the curvature or derivative curvature of anything else. And this invariant describes space-time, strength of the space-time tidal forces. We also require that dimensionless constant B in this relation is universal. That means it does not depend on particular solution, but it depends only on the theory itself. So if the theory satisfies the limiting curvature principle or condition, there is plenty of interesting things which may happen. For example, one can have one or more new universes formation inside the black hole. In cosmology, one can have bouncing solutions. And also, if the curvature is limited by some fundamental constant, one can use this property to solve the so-called mass inflation. So in this talk, I will describe some idea how it's possible to construct limiting curvature model, slightly modifying standard gravitational model. So basic idea is very simple. Suppose we have Lagrangian L, and we have some observable Q, and we would like to impose condition that Q is restricted by some value. So for simplicity, we consider that Q should be negative and never becomes positive. In order to incorporate this property into the theory, we introduce new Lagrangian, which depends on the old dynamical variable Q, as well as two Lagrange multipliers, chi and zeta. So the second term, which is added to this Lagrangian, restrict the growing of the observable Q. How it happens? Let's consider the variation of this Lagrangian with respect to Lagrangian multipliers, we obtain two equations shown in the green color. So in such a theory, a solution can have two different regimes. One, which we call subcritical one, when this observable Q is negative. In this case, constraint equation gives you the value of zeta, and as a result of the second constraint, chi field should vanish. In the supercritical regime, when observable reach its limiting value, zeta becomes zero and chi can be non-zero and becomes a physical field. So I will illustrate how it does work for a simple model of two-dimensional Dilaton gravity. So we start with the standard two-dimensional Dilaton gravity model proposed long time ago. This model was motivated by the string theory, and it was studied in details 30 years ago, and there was plenty of publications. So it contains gravitational metric G, Dilaton field psi, and also it contains some constant lambda, which gives the scale for this theory. We modify this theory by adding additional term which contains constraints. So we denote the constraint Lagrangian multipliers by psi tilde and zeta. And adding this part to the action, we obtain a new action, which is shown in the red color. And we change variables for convenience. Instead of psi tilde, we use psi, which is just psi tilde minus square of Dilaton field. So field equations. So we have constraint equations, Dilaton equation shown in brown, and so-called gravity equation. So the latter equations are obtained by variation of the action with respect to the metric. Subcritical regime of the solution is when curvature, scalar curvature, two-dimensional space is less than fundamental quantity lambda. Basically, it's you can think about lambda as a cosmological constant. In this regime, the field zeta is determined by the condition that zeta square is equal lambda minus r. Chi multiplier vanishes, and we have two equations: Brown equation for Dilaton field, and gravity equations can be written in the form of the blue relation. So it's convenient to change at this point variables instead of Dilaton field psi. Consider another Dilaton field here, which is related as exponent with psi. So the second relation in green shows that the second covariant derivative of some scalar is proportional to the metric. Immediate consequences of this relation is that there exists a Killing vector psi. And this Killing vector is nothing but gradient of phi multiplied by anti-symmetric tensor, anti-symmetric two-dimensional tensor. So in the domain where Killing vector is time-like, one can write a solution, and this is a solution of static two-dimensional black hole. And this form of solution is well known. It was studied in detail by Witten long time ago. You have metric function f, which is basically minus psi square, minus square of the Killing vector. F contains parameter m, the mass of two-dimensional black hole, and it depends on the coordinate r as the exponent minus 2 lambda r. R changes from minus to plus infinity, and Dilaton field psi is exponent of lambda r. So this metric has horizon, and this is a metric of two-dimensional black hole. So we can use this solution in the black hole exterior to construct the solution for eternal black hole. We can do it in the standard two steps, like for Schwarzschild metric. We introduce, first of all, Kruskal coordinates u large and v large. And after, if you would like to construct conformal diagram, we compress infinities to finite distances, introducing by introducing new null coordinates. We denote them p and q. The metric in these coordinates is conformally flat, and conformal factor contains infinities at the point of the physical infinities. So this metric is symmetric with respect to the discrete symmetries, interchange P and Q, and this another symmetry, P to minus Q, Q to minus P. So this is standard conformal diagram for this eternal two-dimensional black hole. It has two special infinities and two time-like domains, one corresponding to the white hole, another to the black hole. And these solid black lines represent singularities of the solution where curvature becomes infinite. So in our limiting curvature theory, the solution will be valid only in domain where the solution is subcritical, and this domain is restricted by the lines where the curvature takes the value lambda. So we would like to prolong the solution beyond this line. So one point I need to stress this, as usual, eternal black hole is usually used to construct physical solution by including matter. So if you have matter which collapsing and forms a black hole, one can use two domains of this complete space-time, R plus and T minus. If the boundary of the matter is in the domain T plus and R plus, we describe a white hole situation. So inside these lines representing the boundary of the black hole, you need to use a metric with the metric inside the matter. We choose our coordinates P and Q in such a way that singularities lines are horizontal lines shown here. So we consider a situation when the boundary line, boundary surface sigma, is inside the black hole. So in order to describe this domain, we can use other coordinates in the black hole interior. So since we have two domains with a high curvature, it's sufficient to consider only one. For simplicity, we shall be speaking only about the black hole domain. The other domain can be reconstructed by using discrete symmetry I mentioned earlier. So inside the black hole, the metric can be written in form of the cosmological metric with a parameter A depending on tau. Tau is a proper time, and T is a Killing coordinate. Inside the black hole, the Killing vector becomes space-like, and parameter T is a special coordinate, and it changes from minus to plus infinity. So relation between the time, proper time, and radial coordinate inside, which is a time-like coordinate, is shown in the brown color. Expression for curvature is this one. And the curvature will have singularity at the finite value of proper time tau. So when tau becomes equal to plus or minus pi over 2 lambda. Dilaton field inside the black hole is also very easy to find. So at the boundary of our subcritical solution at the junction surface sigma, we can find out the value of the quantities which are required to continue our solution further in the supercritical domain. So there is a very important dimensional parameter which will play an important role. So it's very easy to show that the difference of the radius of the apparent horizon position or event horizon position and place where the curvature becomes, becomes critical is proportional to logarithm beta. So in order to have this junction surface inside, the black hole parameter beta must be smaller than one. In later, we consider parameter beta to be less than 1/2. It simplifies some presentation, but we consider all different cases as well in our paper. So the value of the parameter scale factor for our cosmology inside the black hole, A, depends on beta as well as other quantities. So we need a Hubble constant, and Hubble constant have a geometrical meaning. It's just exterior extrinsic curvature of the line tau constant in this geometry. Also, we need to have dilaton field at the junction surface and time derivative of this dilaton field. So what about supercritical regime? So in supercritical domain, curvature is equal to lambda. It means that we have a space time, which at least locally isometric to the sitter two dimensional space. So we use such a de Sitter space has three Killing vectors. And in this representation of the metric, we use a Killing vector which is tangent to our junction surface sigma. It's space-like, and T is the Killing parameter. So in this case, when beta is less than 1/2, scale factor A changes as a cosine hyperbolic of rescaled proper time, and Hubble constant is a tangent hyperbolic of this parameter. Now let's discuss conformal diagram. So conformal diagram for the Sitter two-dimensional world is well known, but there is one delicacy which I need to explain, which differs our case from the usually considered one. So first of all, one can change variables from the proper time tau to new time, which is usually denoted by T large, so that the metric can be written in the conformally flat way. And there is a parameter omega, conformal factor, which is inverse proportional to square of cosine alpha T. Alpha is this parameter, and A1 is a quantity which is found from by gluing this condition solution to the subcritical one. So points where T is equal, alpha T is equal to plus or minus pi over 2 corresponds to the future and past time infinities. So this transformation make coordinate T large compact. So usually it's sufficient to construct conformal diagram, but one delicacy in our problem is the following. So in standard two-dimensional cosmological models, coordinate T small is supposed to be changing in the finite interval, and ends of these intervals identify, so T becomes angle coordinate. In this case, the corresponding conformal diagram is just standard square, which is well known. In our case, T is changing from minus to plus infinity. So we have two more infinities, and to absorb these infinities into the conformal factor, we make another conformal transformation. So instead of coordinates T large and T small, we introduce two null coordinates, P plus and Q plus. So this coordinate change in the interval from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2. So the metric in this new null coordinates is shown in the red color. And this metric has conformal factor, which infinitely grows in future and past time infinity. And it's left and right space infinities. So this is a conformal diagram for the our supercritical solution. It's restricted by two lines representing future and past time infinity. And the space-time looks like length because conformal factor shrinks the points at infinity to finite distance. So sigma surface can be represented at some curve in this space, in this diagram. Very important remark is the following. So one can consider other null coordinates, and one can make the following coordinate transformation, which preserves the property that these coordinates are null. And if this function are finite, monotonous, continuous, and the argument obeys the property that at the endpoints, the ends of these intervals remains the same. We can use this as a new coordinate in our space-time. So in this new coordinates, basically you have the same description for the our supercritical solution, but the form of the lines t equal constant will be deformed. So when we glue our subcritical solution in supercritical one, our matching conditions would allow us to relate initial coordinates p and q with the coordinates in this de Sitter part of our solution, and so that this surface sigma is glued continuously. What are the matching conditions? This is conditions which can be obtained from the complete set of our equations, and they require that the scale factor A is continuous, Hubble constant is continuous, Dilaton field its derivative is continuous, and chi field is also continuous. So after doing this, we obtain the following diagram for the conformal diagram for the our solution, which contains part representing subcritical solution, and also it's glued with the de Sitter part at our surfaces sigma. So this is the expanding de Sitter universe. Oops. And this is a contracting de Sitter universe. So this solution has no any curvature singularities, and it is complete. So what about the fields in the supercritical regime? So Dilaton field obeys very simple equation, and these equations can be integrated. So solutions for, there are two solutions of these equations, real solutions, which are written in terms of the Legendre functions. So basically this solution behaves as follows. They are oscillating, and amplitude of this oscillation exponentially decreases for large time t. What about the chi field? Solution for chi field also can be written in explicit form. So you need to substitute in these integrals the expression for the Dilaton field, which we know exactly, and construct the field chi. So why it's important? We can answer the following question. Suppose we have a subcritical solution which enter at some moment of time to the supercritical regime. What happens later? Can a solution leave the supercritical regime at later time? For this particular model, the answer is no. So this can be analyzed as follows. So one can consider two quantities connected with the Dilaton field and its derivative, and introduce a new quantity Z tilde, which is psi minus psi square, multiplied by some quantities. So, and one can write the first order, set of first order differential equations for these quantities. And after we can integrate these equations and construct the function with the given initial conditions. Conditions that our subcritical solution enter supercritical regime is that at this initial moment of time, this quantity function Z tilde vanishes. So we numerically solve this equation, and the answer is quite stable and simple. So as soon as it leaves this subcritical regime in supercritical domain, this function becomes negative, and after it's saturated and come to the constant value. This property is connected with the following, that Dilaton field, which enters the expression for our chi field, is exponentially decreasing, so integrals are saturated, but main property is that this zeta remains negative, and it cannot return back to the zero value again, so our solution remains, at least in this model, in the supercritical regime. So since I have no much time, I will say a few words about application of this model to the case of formation of operation of black hole. So first of all, we can write our solution in the subcritical regime for two-dimensional Dilaton black hole in advanced time coordinate, coordinates V and R. So function f contains mass parameter, which is constant for our two-dimensional Dilaton black hole, but we can make it function of the advanced time. So, and it's very easy to check that metric in this form obeys all the required equations, provided we include a term describing infalling null fluid. So it's generalization of Wadia solution of general relativity. Now we can use this subcritical solution to glue it together with a supercritical one. Again, in order to have our junction surface inside the black hole, the following conditions must be satisfied. So beta parameter is a 4 lambda small square divided by lambda large. Lambda is a parameter of the Dilaton gravity, and lambda large is a critical value of the curvature. Condition that supercritical domain is inside the black hole is that beta is smaller than one. So it's to represent the solution, it's useful to introduce new coordinate instead of r. Consider exponent of 2 lambda r and denote it by y. So r in subcritical solution changes from minus to plus infinity. Y coordinate change from 0 to infinity. And singularity of subcritical solution would exist at y equal to 0. So this is schematic picture of the black hole, and this red dashed line represents the apparent horizon of this black hole. So we put some special version of mass m of v. So initially mass grows from zero to some maximal value. It's connected with the positive energy flux of null fluid, which results in the formation of the black hole. And after we consider change of the mass when mass is decreasing as a result of the Hawking evaporation. For this particular model, the surface gravity on the apparent horizon is constant. So rate of change of mass is constant. And so one can approximate in this stage mass m of v as a linear decreasing linear function. So one can see that outgoing null rays, which are presented in this picture, they are shown by blue lines, behave as follows. So at the moment of the black hole formation, when mass increases, all these outgoing null rays, which cross the apparent horizon, move to the center of the black hole and enter the Sitter core. So at later time, when mass decreases, some of the rays in the small size skin domain near the apparent horizon can escape to infinity. But most of the rays are propagating to the direction of the black hole core, and they enter the Sitter domain, and most of them go to the time like infinity. Very nice feature is the following, that at the end of the operation, some of the null rays can escape the Sitter core and becomes visible to the external observer. It's very easy to obtain condition when it happens. So suppose M is a function of V, M prime is a derivative of this function with respect to V. So we construct the following positive quantity, M prime divided by M with the minus sign. So condition that a null ray, outgoing null ray, can escape the Sitter core can be written as follows. This quantity should be greater than one over beta minus one. Beta is less than one, so it's some constant. So suppose a black hole emits with a finite rate, lose its mass with a finite rate, and mass of the black hole becomes smaller and smaller. This parameter grows. As a result, at some point of its evaporation, this inequality can become valid. And at this moment of time, the null rays emitted at the boundary of the De Sitter core can leave the black hole and go to external observer. So general conclusion that in this kind of model, at the late time of operation of the black hole, observer, external observer can see some information about the De Sitter core. Certainly all this depends on the details of the evaporation, which are not very certain. So I think my time is almost over. So I would like to summarize my talk as follows. So we propose some general approach of construction of the limiting curvature theory. So this this theory is obtained by modification of the standard Einstein action or other actions by including extra terms which contains constraints. These terms are chosen in a special way so that variation with respect to the Lagrange multipliers gives inequality constraints, and as a result, the solution will have two regimes. Subcritical regime, in this regime, it solution goes basically along its classical trajectory, but as soon as the inequality becomes equality for our control variable, it start moving along the constrained surface. So if there is a more than one inequality, you can include this by increasing the number of corresponding Lagrange multipliers. In this case, evolution can be more complicated. So, so subcritical solution may enter one of the supercritical regime. It can jump from one supercritical regime to another supercritical regime. Finally, it may leave supercritical regimes and return back to the subcritical domain again. So we consider special example of two-dimensional Dilaton gravity and constructed solution corresponding to limiting curvature generalization version of this theory. Eternal black hole in this De Sitter cause, one in the white hole domain, another in the black hole domain. If subcritical solution enters the supercritical regime, for this particular model, it never. Also, we consider wider type solution of this theory, which describes formation and evaporation of a two-dimensional black hole. So in this case, the black hole has one De Sitter core located inside the black hole, describing expanding De Sitter universe. De Sitter core becomes visible at the last stage of black hole evaporation. And this is a basic idea. It can be applied to the more realistic four-dimensional theory. We are working on this subject now, and certainly it will be interesting to find out solution on this kind of limiting curvature gravity models for four-dimensional cosmology and black holes. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much. And I sorry for disappearing on everyone for 8 minutes, but my internet connection went out completely. So there wasn't much I could do but wait for it to come back. So thank you for finishing.
Bob, thank you. Because of your leave, I got 5 minutes more, I hope.
That's so, right. No, you did get, good. Thank I was you. Not able to... you know, since I didn't know when you started, I didn't know when to, you know, okay. drop the hammer. So I did let you just go on. But we still do have a bit of time for questions. And there was a question in the chat from Vladislav Vachowski, sorry for mangling your name, which came in first. So I'll ask that. Which is, what do we know about the solutions for this model in higher dimensions?
So since this work is rather new, we are now working on four dimensions, so high dimension certainly will be later, but basic idea will remain the same, but there will be more invariants you may consider, so more options. So, and you need to think about the symmetry of your problem. So it's black hole or cosmology problem. So basic idea may remain the same, but I don't know. In principle, nothing depends in dimension here. We just use two-dimensional model to have some explicit solution in the known elementary or generalized function. But four-dimensional case can be also, curvature can be restricted in the same manner. So I cannot see why not.
Okay, then the next were people who raised their hands. So Cheyu Chen, please go ahead.
Thank you for the very interesting talk. Well, a naive question, which is, does this model violate some energy conditions?
Certainly, yes. So what happens that in the gravitational equation, you have in the right-hand side, so in our case, it is a dilaton field second derivative and some combination. In the right-hand side, in the standard way, we have T mu nu. And in our case, we have in the supercritical regime contribution from high field. So since our theory is generally covariant, so all the conservation laws are valid. So since curvature is not growing, part of the energy simply goes to amplify high field. So if you look at the matter, stress energy tensor, it may be positive and satisfy energy conditions, but the right hand side is not standard T menu, but has contribution from this Xi field, which is a constrained regulated field. And it certainly must violate energy conditions to make possible to escape singularity.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, next is Igor Volovich.
Thank you for the very nice talk. Actually, I had the same question as the previous one, but now let me ask you, is the generalization of Hawking-Monroe's theorem to two dimensions?
It's a very nice question. I believe it should be, but I don't know the references. So it's...
Okay. But since you have variation of energy condition.
So for energy condition, I suppose you can you have less freedom. So you have two components, energy density and pressure. So you can consider null and other energy conditions. So in the similar way. So I think it can be easily generalized.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Maxim Fitkevich is next.
Thank you. My question is about the Sitter quad. So do I understand correctly that your model has a stable Raymond as an endpoint?
The thing is that in this, it depends. So in this particular model, when we put mass function vanishing at some moment of time, so there is no remnant. So the curvature everywhere is finite. So, but core will disappear at the moment when the black hole disappears itself. But rays emitted by this core can go to external observer. So the end, at the end, you can see this core, but it disappears in this model together with the black hole. It happens because we impose conditions that this particular two-dimensional model, conditions that curvature takes limiting value, which show you the position of the boundary surface. It's separated from apparent horizon in some way, and this coordinates distance in R becomes finite, remains finite, but in coordinate Y, it goes to zero. So they come to zero together. So for this reason, it's not situation with the remnant. So there is no remnant, the Sitter-like remnant in this model.
It's more like a birth of a baby universe, which splits off of the original one.
Sorry?
It's more like a birth of a baby universe.
The thing is that what happens that inside this standard two-dimensional black hole, Dilaton black hole, you have also expanding universe, but the rate of expansion grows too fast. So as a result, you have increasing of the curvature to infinity. In our model, the growth of the curvature is restricted. Mm-hmm. So it becomes constant. So for this reason, it remains constant. So it's again expanding universe, but it's the Sitter-like universe. Mm-hmm. So everywhere finite constant. So this is a modification.
Should mean that your model of entirety is should be violated, because everything that falls into a black hole never escapes. It falls into not singularity, but new infinity.
I'm not sure. So there is a delicate point about end point of evaporation. So I put a linear function up to the end. Mm-hmm. But there are options. You may consider the function which stops somewhere at finite distance, you will have remnant. Mm-hmm. So you may consider fast decreasing. So it may happen that there will be some high curvature domain which disappears, it will be some kind of remnant. But you need to study the endpoint in this kind of model more accurately. So I make simple assumptions that it's a linear function. So certainly a situation with the endpoint, but we don't know really main physics of the when the curvature becomes near the Planck and what is about the rate of the black hole evaporation. So the answer whether it's remnant or completely disappearance, it depends on the details of this model. It's out of my control.
We need to move on, and there were other questions as well. Let me, if Alexander has a very quick question, and even more importantly, Valeri has a very quick answer, go ahead.
I have a kind of short one. It seems that if we want to have a limiting curvature proposal, we need to limit all possible curvature invariants. And in some sense, maybe there is some matching with what, for example, Sergei Soloduchin was discussed before. So maybe exactly those invariants are needed in order to write, so to say, all terms in the quantum action for gravity. Maybe we need to limit all of them.
You know that it's a very nice proposal. And if we meet one term per unit time, it will take infinite time to finish the theory. So I don't know the answer. So certainly you are correct. So in this model, it's sufficient to limit only Kretschmann invariant. So mm-hmm. in spherically symmetric four-dimensional space-time, when you make a limit for Kretschmann invariant, automatically you make limit for Weyl square, Ricci tensor, and Ricci scalar. So you mm-hmm. restrict all these quadratic invariants. Certainly you have derivative invariants. So you may consider this, but you need to start with something.
Mm-hmm. So of course.
We see that for this kind of model, it's sufficient, because in our model, in the supercritical domain, all the derivative of the curvature vanishes. And this field becomes small. So this is sufficient. In more complicated case for realistic black holes, maybe you need to do more. So it's my short answer.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. We need to move on. So thank you very much. Usual one-person Zoom applause, but representing many.